These Colors, The Secret Paintings of General Norman Schwarzkopf. Part 1, The Melzac Collection and the Schwarzkopf Contribution. The CIA has an art collection. Most of it is made up of figurative paintings that depict great moments in intelligence history. Still lives of weapons caches, baroque scenes of cigarette-smoking code crackers, and aerial paintings that look like the box art for military model kits, or maybe the storyboards for a Michael Bay film. The other widely talked about part of their art collection is the Melzac collection, abstract expressionist and color field paintings that stand as a testament to the CIA's widespread and covert funding of art institutions to promote abstract and modernist art as a counter to communist culture in the Cold War. One artist of the Washington Color School, Anne Truitt, whose many contemporaries have their work shown in the CIA headquarters, was asked in an interview if, living in Washington at the height of the Cold War, she devised an abstraction that sought to escape, yet ultimately expressed, U.S. imperialist power. Her response was two words: "That's true." These CIA paintings aren't just trophies to their previous victories. The agents are encouraged, when there's a particularly sticky espionage situation, to contemplate one of the paintings. Carolyn Reams, the agency's social media lead, says, and I quote, "We'll have our guys and gals come down here to do a critical analysis of the paintings. Say you've got to analyze this big, heavy-duty ISIL problem over here. Maybe if you come look at the painting, it will help you think about how to solve the ISIL problem creatively." I had known that in the aftermath of 9/11, the FBI went to the Whitney to study one of Mark Lombardi's drawings that depicted the Bush family's connection to members of the Saudi oil industry who had a role in funding the attacks. The agents had asked that the work be removed. I asked Reams whether the CIA ever sent their agents on similar excursions. She corrected CIA officers, then said yes, though the CIA had a greater respect for the sanctity of art than the FBI. Sometimes, on Wednesdays, when the middle of the week strain starts to show, they'll send two agents out to current exhibitions in New York. They'll drive in the cold blue dawn from their homes in the Virginia suburbs to Union Station, where they take the earliest Acela train into New York City. She remembers almost 10 years ago now, passing the break room one Thursday and hearing an information operations officer animatedly relaying his experience at Corey Archangel's Pro Tools to a colleague. She told me that kind of excitement makes her job worth it. The agent would go on to be one of the leads behind a joint MI6 CIA program that was codenamed Weeping Angel to hack smart TVs and use them as recording devices. I learned about all this at a recent fact-finding trip to the CIA's art collection. Despite only being able to use a factory-sealed memory card and being escorted to the restroom, the CIA was very forthcoming with me, showing me not only the art that was on display, but the never-before-seen pieces in their archives. It was there that I stumbled upon a flat-packed crate. It was about 8 feet wide, 8 feet long, and 4 feet tall. On it was stenciled 4908B, Schwarzkopf Contribution. Very intrigued, I asked Reams what it contained. She explained that they were the notebooks, sketches, and paintings done by General Norman Schwarzkopf, most known as commander of the U.S. Central Command, CENTCOM, the Joint Forces Command in the Middle East. He was most famous for his role as the commander during the first war on Iraq, or the first Gulf War. She explained that he donated the works to the CIA art collection after his death, and was a frequent visitor to the collection, famously spending 1 hour examining Center Grid the morning right before the National Victory Celebration. I asked if I could see the collection, and I was allowed. Together, we pulled out the general's various notebooks, arranging them in haphazard stacks on the wire push carts used to ferry the many cardboard boxes of top secret documents to reading tables scattered all around the massive space. We laid his many drawings and works on paper across the plastic faux wood laminate of three of these tables. Last, we took out his paintings, leaning them up against the high document shelves. For the last painting, Officer Reams and I lifted them out of the crate together, more than once tearing the back knuckles of our plastic gloves on the side of the rough crate. We carried these last few works together, as their canvases were far taller than either of us. Perhaps it was the smooth concrete floor that looked like the ones in the modernist art buildings at my college and university, or the way that we'd leaned the canvases up against the racks, but pacing back and forth down that fluorescent lit hall, I couldn't help but feel like we'd begun to lay out the general's retrospective. I asked Reams if I could photograph his works, but she declined, saying Norman had intended that only the officers here and invited military guests could view them. She did allow me to copy down all of the general's notes and said that I could describe the works in writing. I was initially very disappointed, but as I spent the next few days coming to the CIA headquarters in the cold dawn to work on transcribing and copying what I could, I came to understand that this vast airplane hangar-like basement was the perfect and only place for these works. Schwarzkopf's legacy is a complicated one. The First Gulf War was a brutal campaign, and the general was responsible for genocide and war crimes. The campaign of aerial bombing that began the Gulf War deliberately targeted populated areas and civilian infrastructures. The estimates place the civilian death toll from this bombing at 100,000 people, 60% of them children. Another 100,000 had died by 1 year later from the conditions brought about by this near total destruction of the infrastructure. The campaign against the Iraqi soldiers was equally brutal, with much of the slaughter being done against soldiers who were retreating or in the 2 days after a ceasefire was already declared. Schwarzkopf himself would estimate the death toll for the Iraqi military at 100,000 people. However, Schwarzkopf also, by many accounts, had a deep respect and appreciation for the people and culture of the Middle East. Multiple biographies make note that his family had raised him to be colorblind and retell a story of him offering his seat to an elderly black woman on a bus when he was 10 years old, even though the white passengers looked at him strangely. He is said to have cared very deeply about his men, even when it meant fighting with the higher-ups. In his retirement, he was knighted by the Queen of England, and as I've learned since my visit to the CIA's art collection, he was an accomplished painter. In the rest of this video essay, I will make an attempt to give a fair and balanced portrait of Norman Schwarzkopf, both the general and the painter. I will try to describe these works deemed only to be shown in the stark and shadowed halls of the CIA archive. Hopefully, I can give you a window into Schwarzkopf's artistic practice and its often strange intersection with U.S. foreign policy, covert action, and the military-industrial complex.